SP is a 33-year-old man presenting to the emergency room with chest tightness, wheezing, and a cough. He tries to tell the admitting nurse what happened, but he's so out of breath that words can't come out of his mouth. SP had recently gotten into welding. This is where you use heat to melt metal in order to join pieces together. A Black Friday sale on a welding machine enabled him to learn this highly marketable, practical skill at a great price, and he was determined to join as many pieces of steel as he could with his newly bought welder. SP would take old leftover pieces from his lawn so that he could grind them down, cut them up, and weld them together as new projects. But there was a problem. These old pieces were rusty, and even worse, they were covered with grease and dust. When these contaminate metal surfaces, it makes it harder to get a good weld. Typically, you use an abrasive, a grinding disc, to scratch it off of the surface, but SP was new to this. He knew lasers, he knew car batteries, he knew how to drill holes in metal, but welding was something totally new to him, and he had an idea. SP had worked on old cars before. One of his go-tos when things got too dirty was brake cleaner. Oh, there's some grease that shouldn't be there? Brake cleaner and it's gone. Oh, there's a little bit of rust? Brake cleaner and it's gone. Without a doubt, this will be the easiest way to prep his material so that he can get on with his welding project to make cool things for his house as he laid it on, wiped it off, and started welding. But then something started to smell funny. It smelled like it had just rained and there was wet grass everywhere in his shop. But he wasn't outside. It hadn't rained and grass wasn't anywhere to be found. He had been just welding for long enough to know roughly what things should smell like during and after striking an arc. At first, it felt scratchy in his throat, maybe like something was burning a bit, but then it went away. Not a big deal, he thought. He kept working. He felt okay. Nothing was wrong. He continued working on many different projects, but as the day passed, he started feeling like his lungs were gaining weight. It was like someone had put a garden hose down his throat into his chest and turned on the water. It was getting harder to breathe. At first, he thought that maybe he was allergic to something. He had gotten some new things in his shop recently, so he went into a different room, and he thought he was feeling a little bit better, but his chest kept getting tighter. On the floor, SP's vision started to go dark. He was gasping for air and in a world of hurt. He couldn't take this anymore as he calls for 911, and he's brought to the emergency room where we are now. Hey, quick question. If you're learning something from this video and you like it, and if you aren't subscribed yet, I'd really love it if you did subscribe and come back to see the next video that I post next month too. When people ask me what I do for fun, I tell them I make videos like these because I genuinely enjoy making them. I've been doing on average one a month since 2017, and your time is valuable, so I do my best to make sure that each video is worth your time. Thanks so much, appreciate you. At examination, doctors find that SP is agitated and he has hypertension. Hyper meaning high, tension referring to blood pressure. He has tachycardia, tachy meaning fast and cardia referring to heart rate, and he was gasping for air. He told them that he was working in his shop and he started smelling something funny, but all of his symptoms had gone away shortly after. At this point, he hadn't said anything about welding because he didn't think that that was the problem. He thought he was weirdly allergic to something, but he didn't know what it was. When doctors checked the oxygen saturation in his blood, it was 92%. SP's only 33 years old. He didn't have any known health problems at that point. It shouldn't be 92%. If it's not at least 95% for a healthy 33-year-old, then it means that something is wrong, most notably in his lungs. But when they did an X-ray of his chest, they didn't see anything wrong in his lungs. The patient next to SP in the emergency room. His heart suddenly stops beating. The entire emergency room staff converged onto him to perform CPR to try to resuscitate him, and no one tends to SP. In the ensuing hour, while he was waiting, he started developing a wheeze. He was restless and in a panic because it felt like his lungs were squeezing into his throat. SP's oxygen saturation had dropped down to 80%. With him again now, doctors told him they need to put a tube down his throat so that a machine can breathe for him. They need to sedate him to do this. And he agreed, knowing that something horrible was happening to him. He started telling them everything that he was doing in his shop, the lasers, the car batteries, but also the welding. It was here where one of the doctors had an idea of what might be going on. After intubating him, doctors did another chest X-ray to confirm that the tube was in, and it was here that they noticed a huge amount of fluid had filled into his lungs, something that wasn't there just a couple of hours earlier. And this gives them more clues as to what's happening. Brake cleaner is a chemical called perchloroethylene. It's organic, meaning that it's carbon-containing. It's oily. Colloquially, it's called perch. It's what's used for dry cleaning clothes, which makes sense because perch is more like an oil, and oil doesn't mix with water, hence dry cleaning. And it excels at stripping off grease and cleaning metal surfaces of contaminants. But here's the problem. Perchloro means chlorinated all the way. Chlorine-containing chemicals are some of the scariest ones that we come across every day because of how they react with biological tissue. And even worse, ethylene is also very reactive, made worse with the addition of multiple chlorines. In chemistry, you often need a little something extra to drive a chemical reaction. Sometimes it's the presence of another chemical. Other times it's stirring, or it could be light. But in SP's case, what was that little extra? Welding uses high voltage and high current to melt steel and join pieces of metal together. The kind of welding that SP was using sends electrical current through a wire. The wire melts first, and then the base metal melts after, and a metallic puddle emerges, which when cooled, results in a joined piece. This process is an explosion of energy. Infrared radiation is released. The full spectrum, ultraviolet radiation that comes out can not only blind you if one doesn't have a darkening helmet on, but it can also cause skin cancer if protective clothing isn't worn. Both of these energies will drive chemical reactions, but in SP's case, it's the steel melting temperature with the presence of oxygen that causes a massive, horrible problem. The brake cleaner on SP's steel that he used to clean everything off got oxidized during welding to become phosgene gas. The high heat in the presence of oxygen drove one particular chemical reaction. Welding often smells a certain way. SP smelled something different because this was the only time he had ever used chlorinated brake cleaner on his steel. But what is phosgene gas? In the intensive care unit, doctors see that SP has hypoxemia, hypo meaning low, ox referring to oxygen, and emia meaning presence in blood. Low oxygen presence in blood. And this is happening because fluid keeps accumulating in his lungs. But what happens from this? The reason that we breathe is because oxygen does two things. The first is that it helps our body produce energy. And the second is that it removes the waste associated with energy production. Oxygen is a powerful electron shuttler. Take, for example, iron. Rust forms on it when water is present with oxygen, and that oxygen shuffles the electrons needed to create iron oxide, or rust. Something similar happens in the body. In the mitochondria, powerhouse of the cell, one of the final steps of energy production is the transfer of electrons to oxygen so that the electrical circuit is completed and a mass of positive charge can flow through to generate cellular energy. It's just that in SP's case, the oxygen isn't there because his lungs have filled with fluid and can't pass the oxygen into his blood. This means the first reason that we breathe isn't being fulfilled by SP's lungs, and this isn't his only problem. Upstream the energy process, sugar is broken down to pyruvate, a chemical that's fed into a process that creates carbon dioxide. Breathing out removes this waste, but SP's lungs can't remove carbon dioxide anymore because they're filled with fluid. This becomes a massive problem, and this will be fatal if nothing is done. In the intensive care unit, a blood test finds that SP has acidemia, acid presence in blood. If he can't get oxygen anymore and carbon dioxide can't be eliminated from his body, what does this have to do with acid in his blood? The body has several ways to maintain equilibrium to keep us alive. Blood has water, and it normally also has carbon dioxide. When these are put together in the blood, the body has an enzyme that combines them into carbonic acid. Normally, the body dissociates this into acid and bicarbonate, which is base. And this is the balance that keeps us alive, the equilibrium. But SP isn't in equilibrium. His carbon dioxide buildup shifts the balance heavily towards the production of acid, explaining acidemia. All of this happening because fluid is filling into his lungs. ICU doctors can't remove that fluid quickly enough. But where did this fluid come from? He didn't inhale any liquids. This brings us back to phosgene. Everything about this chemical molecule shows that it's going to react with key structures in the body. Lungs have a soap-like substance called surfactant inside the air sacs called alveoli. This prevents them from collapsing so that the lungs can inflate easily. When phosgene is inhaled, it irritates all of the tissue in the airway and then comes right into contact with the surfactant, and this is where the problems start. that time period where SP initially felt fine after smelling something funny. That was likely Phosgene reacting with surfactant. It irritated his throat, but once it settled into his lungs, it was slowly reacting and setting off a chain reaction. Surfactant is mostly made of fats, and these have oxygen, which reacts specifically to the phosgene. But it isn't just fats. Surfactant is also made of proteins, which are from amino acids. Amine from ammonia, referring to nitrogen, which also reacts to phosgene. What else has nitrogen? That's right, DNA, and it too will react with phosgene. Proteins also have sulfur, because 2 out of the 20 different amino acids that make human proteins have it. Guess what reacts with phosgene? That's right, sulfur does. This brings us back to equilibrium. The lungs directly make contact with the outside world in the form of the air that we breathe in. But Earth's air has never been assumed to have been clean. Humans were alive for hundreds of thousands of years before factories were invented, and the lungs protect us from dirty air using a chemical inside named glutathione, which contains sulfur. And when phosgene is inhaled, it immediately consumes all of the glutathione. It breaks the surfactant, and when it gets through to all of those protective layers, it starts to react with the DNA in the cells, destroying all of them. And this was only the first part of the damage that happened to SP. The moments after his initial symptoms went away were marked by a feeling of his lungs gaining weight, that the atmosphere was slowly falling from the ceiling, crushing down on him. His struggle to breathe was the start of a new phase of damage happening. Once cells start to die, the body detects this. Signals are sent everywhere that something is wrong. Phosgene is known to stimulate the nerves in the lungs. These nerves maintain lung muscle tone. When phosgene is in, the muscles constrict, making breathing more difficult. The massive chain chemical reaction happening to multiple parts of the lungs spill reactive oxidative chemicals everywhere, and the immune system detects this. When the immune system is involved in something, you can expect that proteins and antibodies will start to flood into the area. And so this means that fluid swells into the area and it won't stop, explaining where it's coming from. Even worse, because the phosgene has eaten away at lung tissue, the tissue becomes leaky and regular fluid flows in and builds up, even without the immune system. This is the second stage of damage. It's causing all of SP's problems, and it's made it impossible for him to breathe, even if a machine is trying to do it for him, because his lungs physically can't connect to his body. The immune system might be overreacting here. In the intensive care unit, doctors give SP steroids. These lower inflammation, and they should help in his case. Chlorinated chemicals make great cleaners, but result in really scary situations, every time being vastly different. For example, bleach is hypochlorite. It's chlorinated, and mixing it with acidic household cleaners results in chlorine gas, which is corrosive and immediately damaging to lung tissue. This accident happens thousands of times every year. It's extremely dangerous, but it doesn't just happen with cleaning inside of homes. Swimming pools also use chlorinated products, and mixing pool cleaners can not only liberate massive amounts of chlorine gas, but it can also form a chemical named nitrogen trichloride, which is well known to explode, which means that we used it to bleach flour and found out the hard way that it caused psychotic symptoms in pets before being banned as a food additive in 1949. During Christmas, families might use bubble lights. Every year, there's a spike of calls to the poison center because little kids might get in and accidentally drink the contents. These lights have a solvent inside called methylene chloride, which gets into the body, gets broken down to carbon monoxide, and can cause those kids to suffocate in a totally different way from what's happening to SP. In the intensive care unit, the steroids weren't working. Fluid was still swelling into his lungs. His oxygen saturation was decreasing and his acidemia was worsening, which means that the carbon dioxide buildup was quickly reaching a critical point. The heart is very energy intensive and it needs continuous waste removal on a time scale of seconds. As the acid builds up in his blood, it starts to impair the electrical conduction that's needed for the heart to continue to beat. An irregular rhythm starts to appear. The medical team can still take steps to correct it for now, but without fixing the root cause of fluid flooding into his lungs, everything is just a temporary fix. Phosgene was a well-known occupational hazard. Back in the 1980s, there was a huge alarm that was set off that there was a hole in the ozone layer of Earth. And this was because of our use of chlorofluorocarbons, or CFCs, which were refrigerants used in HVAC systems, refrigerators, and cars. And sometimes technicians working on these systems would need to weld parts of these systems that contain CFCs. And phosgene gas could be created if they didn't clean it out with nitrogen first. It's starting to become more rare to find these since CFCs aren't made anymore and new refrigerants don't have chlorine. It's easier now than ever to get into welding. Even I know how to do it. And this is the exact welder that I had when I had my workshop and welded together shelves for my minivan with the help of my friend Wolfgang. But one of the things that come with easy accessibility is that you might run into issues that come from lacking awareness if you aren't working with someone who knows how to do that thing. You might not know that you really need to wear long sleeves while welding because of the UV radiation that comes out. Some people might not realize that you should wear a mask when you're grinding steel. They might do it, and then they'll shower at night and then cough up pure black soot, not realizing that they were inhaling all of that, or maybe they just didn't even want to wear the masks to begin with. There's a lot of good singular education resources out there, but they are singular, and there's a lot of fragmentation. It's not always easy to find more complete resources that would cover some pretty important mistakes that aren't all that difficult to make. Things fall through the cracks, and you have to remember for some people starting out, at best, they know nothing. And at worst, they think they've thought of something cool, only for it to be one of the worst possible accident setups that you could possibly have, bringing us back to SP. In the intensive care unit, the medical team tried multiple different medicines. If phosgene reacts with nitrogen and sulfur on proteins, there's a well-known medicine that has both, but can also replenish some of the glutathione that was consumed by the phosgene. But it didn't work. When we put all of these concepts together, we find something truly scary. A highly valuable, marketable skill being easily accessible could lead one who has some knowledge of some things to get his own ideas while performing that skill, and it results in a poisoning. But not just any poisoning. It's one where a person can be exposed, not realize it, initially feels fine in the hours after. Slowly, as symptoms build, all of a sudden, everything drops. Irreversible lung damage opens the floodgates. The immune system response only helps push forward the notion that the entire body is going to quickly suffocate as acid builds up over the hours. There's no antidote. There's no way to take the phosgene out of the lungs. And there's no way that we know of currently to reverse the damage once it's set in motion. The moment that the phosgene gas is inhaled, it's over. It's just that it takes hours to manifest, and during that time, there's a period where everything seems fine, but it isn't, just like in SP's case. At 31 hours after exposure to phosgene gas, SP's profound hypoxemia with respiratory acidosis and fulminant pulmonary edema was overwhelming his body. Another abnormal heart rhythm appeared. It quickly changed into his heart, just shaking in place, not being able to actually circulate any blood in his body anymore. And doctors weren't able to resuscitate him. Always be alert when around chlorinated chemicals and never mix them together. It's a wonderful thing to have a workshop and make things from different materials with different tools. It's an absolute joy to produce custom-made things in the physical world with your hands. But always try your best to know what's safe and what isn't. Thanks to my good friend Styro Pyro for portraying patient SP. The case this video was based off is real, but it wasn't specifically Styro Pyro. I was lucky enough to be in his shop and see the cool stuff that he's made for his videos, which you should definitely check out here if you haven't yet. His videos are some of my favorites on YouTube going on for many years now. Thanks so much for watching. Take care of yourself and be well.